nosotros se encuadra también dentro del Observatorio Cultural de los European Design Labs. Como habéis seguido durante estos dos últimos años, precisamente ciclos como este se crearon para invitar a distintos expertos, desde la antropología y la filosofía al diseño gráfico, diseño industrial, para intentar dar una serie de claves sobre los retos más inmediatos o las oportunidades más candentes del inmediato futuro. Por eso mismo, después de haber iniciado este nuevo ciclo con Francisco Jarauta hace un mes, y después de ciclos como el que tuvimos de empresa e innovación, precisamente algunos de los temas que hemos visto que más vigencia tenían, como ha podido ser el caso de Javier Romero, habló ya este tsunami digital, o con Enric Ruiz Gelli, precisamente, que ha supuesto este paso a lo digital en la arquitectura, era obligado tener precisamente un tipo de discusión en el campo editorial, y nada mejor que este ciclo que Fran Merino ha coordinado para el IED. Y bueno, simplemente le voy a dejar la palabra a él, agradeciéndoos a todos que hayáis venido, a Fran, que como muchos de vosotros conocéis ha sido Design Manager de NTV España, tiene webs maravillosas que os aconsejo como Descubre Rural, y que nos hace especial ilusión precisamente alumno del IED hace ya bastante tiempo. Tenemos hoy también a Álvaro Ortiz, Ricardo Basurto, Álvaro Barona. Yo recuerdo ya a todos que hoy es solo la primera jornada de dos más. Mañana tendremos a Javier Maseda, Mario Tascón, Antonio Pasagali, y cerraremos con Ian Adelman, que le agradecemos ya su presencia desde hoy. Muchas gracias a todos y os dejo con Fran Merino.
Lo que vamos a hacer, o lo que voy a hacer en un principio, es poneros un vídeo para un poco que os hagáis la idea de los temas que vamos a tratar. Es un vídeo, está en inglés, perdonad porque no está en español, es de la CBS e intenta hacer un resumen de cómo están cambiando el mundo de los medios, de la prensa escrita a los medios online, ¿no? Son escasamente 9 minutos, no creo que sea muy pesado, pero así es como un prólogo a todo lo que podemos llegar a hablar esta tarde. Si nos importa, me levanto y lo pongo.
Under siege, the old newsroom cry of stop the presses has taken on a new and depressing meaning. Our cover story is reported by Jeff Greenfield.
When it comes to news about the news these days, no news is good news.
In Denver, they stopped the presses for good today. After nearly 150 years in operation, the Rocky Mountain News published its final edition.
Then the Minneapolis Star Tribune filed for bankruptcy protection.
And the Seattle Post-Intelligencer is set to close if a buyer isn't found by April.
Are we really facing the demise of the great Metropolitan Daily? It was, after all, the newspaper that became as powerful a force as any it covered, the kind of power Charles Foster Kane delighted in wielding.
Is that really your idea of how to run a newspaper?
I don't know how to run a newspaper, Mr. Thatcher. I just try everything I can think of.
It was the newspaper that brought news of crime and corruption to its readers, with an energy and occasional manic recklessness captured in the classic His Girl Friday.
Hello, Duffy, get set. We got the biggest story in years.
And it was the newspaper whose proudest moments came when it held the powerful to account, even bringing down all the president's men.
Is there any proof they're trying to bug the National Democratic chairman?
I think it's obvious they're trying to bug O'Brien. They wouldn't go all that trouble to bug secretaries.
No, there's no proof.
But wait a minute.
Hard as it is for those of us whose day cannot begin without the newspaper, it is a medium that cannot survive without dramatic change. Indeed, it's not clear if it can survive as we know it at all. But does that mean an enormous vacuum, an absence of the kind of information a democratic society needs?
It's the end of the newspaper business right now, this point in time.
Why is longtime media watcher Michael Wolff predicting the imminent end of the newspaper? Consider the facts. Just since 2000, daily newspaper circulation has dropped from 55 million to 50 million. In the last 2 years alone, print ad revenue for papers dropped 28%, more than $11 billion, and that was before the recession really kicked in. Classified ads, the most profitable of all, have migrated to the web on sites like Craigslist. And while the newspaper does have a home online, readers don't pay a dime to read it. Just ask the next generation.
The internet is something that we constantly have with us. I constantly have my laptop on.
I read the New York Times online, the Washington Post online.
Realistically, I prefer the internet. I do, because things are updated constantly.
For newspaper veterans like former Des Moines Register editor Geneva Overholser, now dean of the USC School of Journalism, the potential loss of the newspaper is a clear and present danger to our civic life.
Newsrooms in newspapers have been the predominant source of original reporting about what's going on in City Hall and in classrooms, about Washington, about the international scene. There'll be a time when we really do need to stand up and say, wait a minute, it's getting pretty close.
By contrast, Michael Wolff is highly optimistic about the future.
It is potentially an incredibly good time. We have a much, much bigger audience than we've ever had before. We can do it faster, we can do it better, we can even do it prettier than ever before.
Michael Wolff is putting his energy behind his ideas. He's founded the Newser.com website. But the site itself illustrates the uncertain nature of the future. Just about everything it offers is not his, but content that is aggregated, as they say, from existing newspapers. The Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, the Daily Telegraph, the Washington Post.
So could I ask a blatantly obvious question?
Please.
If all these things go away, what are you going to aggregate?
Were they to go away, I can guarantee that I can deliver the same information and at the same quality from a broad range of other sources.
There's evidence that some of those new sources are already here. TalkingPointsMemo.com is a reported blog with a liberal perspective. It broke the story last year about U.S. attorneys allegedly fired for political reasons. Instapundit.com, with a conservative libertarian tilt, provides analysis and opinion. And what about the local angle? Editors, you know, always tell their reporters to get the local angle. Well, you can't get more local than the suburban community of Montclair, New Jersey.
This is cute.
Where Deborah Gallant and Liz George have launched a website, baristanet.com.
We're much more dynamic. People are coming, they're having a conversation, they're exchanging ideas and opinions. You can't do that on the local newspaper site.
It's produced from their living rooms and from a coffee shop. And they say the web offers powerful advantages over the printed page, quite apart from the cost advantages of no paper, no presses, no delivery cost.
If you hear helicopters overhead and you think, is there a police search going on? Is there some kind of news breaking? You're not going to wait till Thursday till the local paper comes out. You're going to go right to baristanet.com and see what's going on up the street.
But for Mark Porter, editor of the Montclair Times, baristanet.com represents something very different.
And they're primarily just like a lamprey eel feeding off the work of another entity. They haven't gone to the meeting, they haven't interviewed the five or six sources that a reporter has done for a newspaper, and it really is pilferage.
So, can the immediacy of the web and the depth of the traditional newspaper somehow be fused?
That's a large audience. You know,
in Philadelphia, entrepreneur Brian Tierney and a consortium of wealthy investors bought the 180-year-old Philadelphia Inquirer and the tabloid Daily News some 3 years ago. They've placed a multi-$100 million bet that the papers can adapt and survive.
We had a series recently on the EPA and the Bush administration. It took several months to do. It cost $250,000 to do that. I can't do that with two bloggers. I can't do that the way all news radio in this market does it, where they basically buy our newspaper and then paraphrase our stories every day. We are the originators of the investigative work that needs to be done.
But Tierney is facing the same dilemma every paper is. While he could save a fortune becoming web-only, readers don't pay for it, and advertisers won't pay nearly what they do for a print ad. One answer, he says, readers will have to start paying, either with a subscription or a so-called micropayment, a few cents for each article they click on the web.
Not that much money, given the overall scope of what television bills and cell phone bills and all the rest of it our cable bills are. And I think people will pay it.
At the heart of Tierney's efforts to save the enterprise is the website, philly.com, where content from the Inquirer and the Daily News is combined with original fare.
A package on the mayor's budget proposal.
It sounds like the kind of editorial meeting any newspaper has, but there are big differences.
We could also leave the video.
The website folds in video.
Probably some of the best broccoli rub I've had in town.
Text, music, It updates constantly, changing its look and content by the hour.
So I'm wondering if those would do better at 1 and do the music as a light lunchtime.
More opinion right after lunch, for instance, when users might...
...that would replace newspapers.